Lawinen sind seltene, aber tödliche Ereignisse.
Avalanches are rare but deadly occurrences. That's why it is particularly important to avoid triggering them. The main problem when it comes to avalanches is being buried in the avalanche and suffocating, or being hurled against an obstacle, for example a tree, by the avalanche itself, and suffering much severe physical injuries that you die from then. With modern methods, avalanches can largely be avoided. Out in nature, in the winter, there is no 100% certainty. That's why you have to be well prepared. Being well prepared means, firstly, having a full set of the right equipment that is also functional, and secondly, being well trained in comprehensive emergency management. This means that everyone who is out in the mountains must have mastered comprehensive emergency management.
We know that the survival curve drastically falls off after 15 minutes. That means that within the first 15 minutes, a victim's chances of survival are still 90%. So if we manage to uncover the avalanche burial victim within these 15 minutes, we have a very good chance.
Because we travel steep slopes individually as standard, there should never be a problem with the group being able to see who was caught by the avalanche and where. The important aspects here are the victim's last seen point and the primary search area, which is located in the direction of flow, below the point at which the victim went missing. If you know the primary search area, rescue services can work strategically.
The whole companion rescue procedure can be practiced using a kind of basic model. The first requirement is to keep calm. Take a few seconds to get an overview of the situation and to know that you will do your best. You then look at the group to see who's the most highly skilled. This person should take charge.
The person leading the group must maintain an overview of the entire rescue effort and appoint roles to people. For example, someone should immediately make an emergency call, and the people who will be conducting the avalanche transceiver search must be assigned. The others can, for example, start preparing shovels and probes or the helicopter landing site. The person who makes the emergency call should first know where they are situated, meaning that a good indication of location accelerates rescue success, because the organized rescue services can get to the accident site more quickly. The recommended emergency number is the European emergency number, 112. Alternatively, you can use emergency call apps that send the location along with the call. Basically, the person who makes the emergency call should answer the call handler's questions. When doing this, you need to know that the rescue effort has been running simultaneously from the beginning. Therefore, if you're on the phone with the call handler for a long time, you shouldn't have to worry that it will delay the rescue services.
Depending on the situation, so on the size of the avalanche, the number of burial victims, the number of helpers, and the ability of the helpers, I need to decide whether I should search the avalanche deposit zone alone following the search strip width, or whether several people should scan the field in parallel lines. All of the people assigned to the search should then switch their avalanche transceivers to search mode. All other people who are available to help, for example by preparing shovels and probes, must switch their avalanche transceivers either to standby mode or off if there is no threat of a secondary avalanche, so that they do not disturb the search. Depending on the location of the group, the search should start at the victim's last seen point, so from the top down, or alternatively from the foot of the avalanche deposit zone up.
The entire search procedure can be split into several phases: the signal search, the coarse search, the fine search, and pinpointing. The entire thing can be compared to the landing approach of an airplane. In the signal search, you are inexact but move very quickly. It's about finding the main direction. In the coarse search, you already have a direction on your avalanche transceiver and a distance display. You get more and more accurate, but you also slow down slightly. Then in the fine search, you move very precisely. You land on the runway, so to speak. You move slowly and look at the distance display only. At the end comes the pinpointing stage with the probe. Then the digging starts.
For the signal search, the avalanche deposit zone has to be searched systematically. The aim is to get the first signal reception. To do this, the searchers walk the area in search strips. The size of these search strips depends on the reception reach of the searching devices, but must be at least 20 meters. If only one person is conducting the signal search, they walk the field in a meandering pattern. If several people are searching, they should walk along the avalanche deposit zone in corresponding search strips parallel to one another.
During the signal search, it is important to observe all signs of the burial victim. This means that when searching the surface, you should look to see whether any objects or parts of the burial victim's body are visible. At the same time, you should listen for whether the transceiver is giving off a signal. Looking at the avalanche transceiver screen doesn't make sense because you need your eyes to move forward rapidly and spot any potential signs of the burial victim. As you get closer to the burial victim, you will get the first reception of their signal. This is where the signal search ends and the core search begins. There will be an announcement or a beep. This initial signal should also be communicated to the group by loudly shouting, "Signal!" This is important information for the overall management of the accident, particularly for the person leading the group. With the first reception, the signal search moves on to the core search. In the core search, you get a distance display and a direction display. You follow these quickly. As a rule, you move along the field line in an arc toward the burial victim. At the beginning of the core search, you move more quickly. The closer you get, the slower you move. When you are 10 meters away, you slow down significantly once more. You should once again communicate these 10 meters to the group because the leader might already be able to start sending over the shovelers. As you slow down, you also get more precise. This means you move almost exactly in a straight line toward the burial victim. When you reach 5 meters at the latest, you should be directly over the surface of the snow, and at 3 meters, you should be looking only at the distance display. We are now in the fine search.
In the fine search, the device is lowered down to the snow surface and the first axis is scanned. The lowest value on the first axis is marked and serves as a crossover point. This point is crossed over once to the right and left. The lowest distance is then marked using a beanie, headband, or glove. This suspected burial location is where we pinpoint using the probe.
Once you have marked the location with the lowest value, you start pinpointing. That means that one of your group members gives you a probe, or if you're alone, you take your shovel and probe out of your backpack. When doing this, your backpack should always remain on your body, especially if you have an airbag, because it serves as your protection.
When pinpointing the victim, an area of 1 to 2 square meters must be quickly and systematically probed. The first probe is placed directly in the marked spot. After that, the field is systematically probed in intervals of 20 to 30 centimeters, either in a chessboard or spiral formation. A probe hit is indicated by a sudden and significant change, meaning a decrease in penetration depth. At the same time, I feel a soft bounce. When probing, the probe should always be used with two hands to prevent the probe deviating to the right or left. And it should always be inserted at a 90-degree angle to the snow surface. If I get a probe hit, the probe should stay put to mark the spot. The burial depth can be read off of the probe. I then move 1 to 1.5 times the burial depth back from the probe and start shoveling. Shoveling is the most time-consuming and physically tiring phase of the search. For this reason, it is incredibly important to work systematically. When shoveling in a three, you take up a V formation. This means two people shovel at the front, while the person at the back clears the snow away. This creates a ramp that leads down to the burial victim.
If three or more people are involved in uncovering the victim, you can swap positions. This allows you to keep up a good digging pace over a longer period. Ideally, you should leave the shovels behind when you swap because the back shovel will be set to its clearing function. This saves time again. As you shovel closer to the victim's body, the probe can give you a good indication of this. You should start shoveling more carefully. But the important thing when you reach the body is to immediately locate the position of the head with the aim of getting oxygen to the brain. This means immediately upon reaching the body, you dig toward the head with all of your might, and at the end, you can even use your hands. Once you reach the head, there are three possible outcomes. The best outcome is that the burial victim opens their eyes and is conscious and responsive. Then you can take your time. The victim should be carefully freed from the snow, positioned, and cared for following the ABC method. Here, keeping them warm is paramount. The second possible outcome is that the burial victim is unconscious but breathing. Again, you can take your time. The victim should be carefully freed from the snow because you must always consider that they are the victim of a high-speed accident, meaning that they may have physical injuries. The third possible outcome is that the burial victim is not breathing. In this case, you must rapidly dig them out and immediately begin resuscitation to keep the burial victim alive.
To prevent the person getting even colder, you should wrap them in additional clothing, a bivy bag, and rescue blankets. To protect them from the cold below, you should lie them on backpacks, preferably in a hole you have dug to protect them against the wind and from getting even colder. Avalanches are always extremely stressful situations. Only by practicing the procedures will I have a chance of quickly saving a life in an emergency.